Catholic.
Family, a prayer that we pray together is a powerful prayer. So please pray together with me our EWTN family prayer. Today we make an act of hope. O Lord God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, you have taught us not to be afraid nor to worry about tomorrow. You have revealed that all things are possible to the one who trusts. And so, Lord God, I hope by your grace for the pardon of all my sins, and after life here to gain eternal happiness, because you have promised it, who are infinitely powerful, faithful, kind, and merciful. In this hope I intend to live and die. Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood.
Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Christ, Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who gave the priest Saint Bernardine of Siena a great love for the holy name of Jesus, grant through his merits and prayers that we may ever be set aflame with the spirit of your love. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the letter of St. James. Do not complain, brothers and sisters, about one another, that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing before the gates. Take as an example of hardship and patience, brothers and sisters, the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Indeed, we call blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of the perseverance of Job. And you have seen the purpose of the Lord, because the Lord is compassionate and merciful. But above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear, either by heaven or by earth, or with any other oath. But let your yes mean yes, and your no mean no, that you may not incur condemnation.
Verbum Domini.
The Lord is kind and merciful.
The Lord is kind and merciful.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all my being bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits.
The Lord is kind and merciful.
He pardons all your iniquities. He heals all your ills. He redeems your life from destruction. He crowns you with kindness and compassion.
The Lord is kind and merciful.
Merciful and gracious is the Lord, slow to anger and abounding in kindness. He will not always chide, nor does he keep his wrath forever.
The Lord is kind and merciful.
For as the heavens are high above the earth, so surpassing is his kindness towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far as he put your transgressions from us.
The Lord is kind and merciful.
Amen.
You shall be the joy of those who love your name, for you, O Lord, bless the just man.
Santi Evangelii secundum Marcum.
Gloria divina.
Jesus came into the district of Judea across the Jordan. Again the crowds gathered around him, and as was his custom, he again taught them. The Pharisees approached him and asked, "Is it lawful for a husband to divorce his wife?" They were testing him. He said to them in reply, "What did Moses command you?" They replied, "Moses permitted a husband to write a bill of divorce and dismiss her." But Jesus told them, "Because of the hardness of your hearts, he wrote you this commandment. From the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, no human being must separate." In the house, the disciples again questioned Jesus about this. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery."
Verbum Domini.
From the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. When we hear the words of Jesus, when we see what he does, because he is God made man, his words are the human translation, so to speak, of the words of God. That we can have no question about God's intention, his desire to bless that which he has created as the natural sacrament of male and female joined together, that they would be one flesh, no longer able to be separated by any human power, that this is God's design. And not design in a sense of an impersonal or even something as just an ideal that we can go about as we wish, creating marriage however we'd like it to be. But this alone, male and female, where we are joined together for life, despite for richer or poorer, for health or sickness, that intention when the man and woman make their vows to give themselves for life, until death, in total openness to children, in openness to total fidelity, that never will another enter in, not just in relations, but also putting out anything that is contrary to that conjugal love, that only this one, only that one. So no. And then finally, that fidelity in the fullness of life. So it is not a, marriage is not a 50-50 relationship. It won't work that way. It breaks down that way. Just as our Lord gave himself totally unto us, totally unto death, so the man is to give himself 100% unto death for his wife, and if God wills, for his children. The woman, as the image of the church, who loves Jesus with all her heart, and that we all, as baptized members of the church, are to give our lives totally to God. We belong to God. Only when we give ourselves totally in love will we find true freedom, true joy, true happiness. So the grace of the sacrament of matrimony, not just the natural union, but the sacrament of matrimony, is this love which comes from the divine heart of Jesus. This love which comes from that mystical body, that bride of Christ, the church, that all of us are united in that love for God. The sacrament is also directed towards the holiness of the couple, the holiness of the children. And just as priesthood, holy orders, does not make us priests perfect and holy in every way we wish it worked that way, marriage too, both of these sacraments are called in the Catechism sacraments in the service of communion. That we only become holy in these two sacraments if we give ourselves in love, if we die to ourselves, if we give ourselves in service of the other, in service of our children, in service of the human community. God gives grace to those who are generous. Finally, that indissolubility comes from God, is rooted in God. And in the practice of the Catholic Church, annulments are not Catholic divorces, but recognitions that those persons, though that man and that woman, just even one of them, at the time of their consent, when they made those vows, there was something missing or something wrong with that binding, so the actual bond is not created. So it's a recognition in the public sphere, because the sacrament of marriage is a public sacrament, that everyone comes and we witness those two people taking their vows, that in the public sphere now, the church is recognizing that bond did not happen. And so the person then is free to marry another. But if a person enters into marriage in the public sphere, they cannot in the private sphere, or what we call the internal forum, that is in confession and penance, or in simple counseling with a parish priest, they cannot make that recognition happen. That's internal. I can't just have a conversation. And part of that is also an element of justice, that everyone in every party concerned, as much as we're able, within reason, has to have their voice heard. That there's always another person in this. And yes, there were, in marriage, as in life, there are difficulties, and difficulties have to be worked out. But not to let the hardness of our hearts, our difficulty in understanding this teaching from Jesus, which the disciples admit, this is a hard teaching, who can accept it? What does Jesus say? Just as in the proclamation of the Most Holy Eucharist. He does not go back on his word. This is the divine word, the divine intention. That from the beginning, God made them male and female, and that the two shall be one flesh. This is a great sacrament, a mystery that reveals to us the love of Christ for his church, the love of the church, his bride, for God. This is a grace. So let us hear the voice of the Lord and uphold this sacrament that God made them male and female. God is full of love for all who call upon him. Let us offer our petitions in firm confidence, knowing that no plea will go unheard.
For our Holy Father, that he may be blessed with the gifts of courage and integrity and increasing witness to Christ, we pray to the Lord. That all nations may come to know the glory and freedom of the children of God, and live in lasting peace, we pray to the Lord. For the sick and the poor, the weak and the dying, that the Lord may be their comfort and refuge in the midst of suffering, we pray to the Lord. For the faithful departed, that the Lord will receive them into the light of his eternal kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
In your love, Lord, answer our humble prayer. Give us the grace to see what we have to do and the strength to do it through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
brother, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look upon the sacrificial gifts we offer Almighty God on the feast day of Blessed Bernardine of Siena, and grant that we who celebrate the mysteries of the Lord's Passion may imitate what we now do through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as on the festival of St. Bernardine you bid your church rejoice, so too you strengthen her by the example of his holy life. Teach her by his words of preaching, and keep her safe in answer to his prayers. And so with the company of angels and saints we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, 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 Dominus Deus Sanctus, Plenis Sunt Genii et Terra, Gloria.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. From the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Thank you.
Mysterium Fidei.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Bernardine of Siena, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Robert our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Per ipsum ecum ipso et in ipso, est tibi Deo Patri omnipotenti, in unitate Spiritus Sancti, omnis honor et gloria, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Precepti salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere.
Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, iat
pacem in diebus nostris, ut obe misericordiae tua adiuti, et peccatos sino semper liberi, et ab omni perturbatione securi, expectantes beatam spem, ad adventum salvatoris nostri, Iesu Christi.
Qui amat tuum est fecumen, quod
Christe, quid
existi apostolis tuis, pacem relinquo vobis, pacem meando vobis. Ne respicias peccata nostra, sed fidem ecclesiae tuae, eamque secundum voluntatem tuam, pace vicare e quadenare dinieris, qui vivis et regnas in saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo. Agnus Dei, quid omnis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, quid omnis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, quid omnis peccata mundi, ora nobis facere.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. What I say to you in the darkness, speak in the light, says the Lord. What you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops.
For those who cannot now receive Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, we offer the following prayer. Soul of Christ, sanctify me. Body of Christ, save me. Blood of Christ, inebriate me. Water from the side of Christ, wash me. Passion of Christ, strengthen me. O good Jesus, hear me. Within thy wounds, hide me. Suffer me not to be separated from thee. From the malicious enemy, defend me. In the hour of my death, call me, and bid me come to thee, that with thy saints I may praise thee for ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
This mystery, O Lord, confirm your servants in the true faith, that they may everywhere profess in word and deed the faith for which Blessed Bernardine of Siena never ceased to labor, and for which he spent his whole life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et vos spiritus tuo.
Vos omnipotens Deus Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite missa est.
Deo gratias.
Jesus, eternal priest, keep thy priests within the shelter of thy sacred heart, where none may touch them. Keep unstained their anointed hands, which daily touch thy sacred body. Keep unsullied their lips, daily purpled with thy precious blood. keep pure and unworldly their hearts, sealed with the sublime mark of thy priesthood. Let thy holy love surround them from the world's contagion. Bless their labors with abundant fruit. May the souls to whom they minister be their joy and consolation here, and their everlasting crown in heaven. Amen.
Without ministerial priesthood, there is really no possibility to, as it were, mediate the very life of the Church, because the Eucharist is the beginning and the fulfillment of the life of the Church, as we read in the documents of the Second Vatican Council in Sacrosanctum Concilium. The Eucharist makes the Church. The Eucharist maintains the Church. The Eucharist completes, as it were, the Church, because it mediates the life of Christ, which is the life of the Church. That is why without ministerial priesthood, there is no universal priesthood, because it's the ministerial priesthood that guarantees the sacramental life, which is the life of the soul. Without the sacramental life, this universal priesthood withers, and it withers in this longing and in this hunger for God. We want to feed on God. We need to feed on God in order to nourish our souls and our life in this world for the next world. That is why I say that the ministerial priesthood allows for the universal priesthood to realize itself, to maintain itself, and to complete itself through the sacramental life.
They share the most intimate moments of life and death with us. They pour the water of life into our souls. They feed us with living bread from heaven. They're waiting in the confessional to unburden. They receive the vows that transform man and woman into husband and wife. They're with us when we're sick, our final escorts from time into eternity. Abuse, greed, sexism, none of that sums up the priesthood. And the failure of the few can't define hundreds of thousands of good men. One word summed up the priesthood: love. Not the flawed love of human beings, but love that created space and time, hung on a cross, rose from the dead, and promised that he'd never leave us, and who reaches out to the world today through the hands of his priests.
Priestly apostles are my anointed ones, and I call them my Christs, because I have given them the office of administering me to you, and have placed them like fragrant flowers in the mystical body of Holy Church. In all souls, I demand purity and charity, that they should love me and their neighbor. But far more do I demand purity in my ministers, and love towards me and towards their fellow creatures, administering to them the body and blood of my only begotten Son with the fire and charity and the hunger for the salvation of souls, for the glory and honor of my name.
It was the night of the Last Supper. Jesus knew the time had come for him to leave the world. Yet he wanted to remain with us, just as personally as if he had never left. How did he accomplish this? By instituting the priesthood. From generation to generation, he would handpick men to minister in his person. St. John Vianney said, "If we were to fully realize what a priest is on earth, we would die, not of fright, but of love." Is this really how we view our priests? Even though priests are human and imperfect, they bring us the sacraments, including the forgiveness of sins. It is through the office of the priesthood that Christ accomplishes his saving work. How can we not then pray for our priests, affirm them, and lift them up? St. Vianney said, "What use would be a house filled with gold were there no one to open its door?" The priest holds the key to the treasures of heaven. It is he who opens the door.
Each day, the world is blessed by the heroic dedication of holy Catholic priests serving in our parishes and religious orders, in nursing homes and hospitals, and as military chaplains around the world. Since the secular culture is often quick to criticize Catholic priests, it's so important for us to offer our prayers and gratitude for the countless holy Catholic priests who serve humanity with courageous virtue and dedication to Jesus and the gospel. EncouragePriests.org was launched by the Catholic Media Apostolate, CatholicsComeHome.org, during the Year for Priests to support our priests and promote vocations. By visiting EncouragePriests.org, you'll be able to help the priests in your life through spiritual bouquets, written or video greetings, and collar-holler e-cards. Let's pray daily for our seminarians, priests, bishops, and our Holy Father who bring us the sacraments and help guide our path to heaven. Thank you for joining us in this apostolic mission of EncouragePriests.org and CatholicsComeHome.org.
Trusted series, features, and specials from EWTN Home Video. The EWTN Home Video highlight for May is Heaven, Classic Talks by Mother Angelica. What does heaven look like, and what might we expect there? Will we be able to see our loved ones? Mother answers these and many more questions about heaven in this classic series.
You're afraid. That's why we don't want to think of it. I got to get you to the place you want to think of the glory that is to come. The absolute joy.
Order your DVD set at EWTNRC.com 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Or call 1-800-854-6316.
Father's prayer intention for the month of May is that in every country of the world, women may be honored and respected, and that their essential contribution to society may be highly esteemed. The intention for evangelization is that families, communities, and groups may pray the Holy Rosary for evangelization and peace.
Real
presence is the dogma stating that at the consecration during Mass, the bread and wine become the real and true body and blood of Jesus Christ and are not just signs or symbols. All that remain of the bread and wine are the outer appearances.
Lord Jesus Christ, at your Last Supper, you prayed to the Father that all should be one. Send your Holy Spirit upon all who bear your name and seek to serve you. Strengthen our faith in you, and lead us to love one another in humility. May we who have been reborn in one baptism be united in one faith under one shepherd. Amen.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
From behind the Iron Curtain, where we're at now, something wonderful happened. Our Lord appeared to a little Polish nun named Faustina Kowalska. He appeared 82 times. And the subject of their conversations was the love of God, a new way.
Congratulations, thanks for the time. Yes, sir, thank you. A lot of positives in this game for James Franklin. Just 38 rushing yards allowed for his team after 341 a week ago against Pitt, and the offense really continuing to progress.
Yeah, I thought McSorley really played well. He had the one interception, but outside of that, I thought he made some good decisions with the football. It's about putting it in a place where guys can be able to make plays. He's nice and comfortable in the pocket, steps outside, eyes are downfield. We've seen this play. What a great play by a talented receiver there to be able to make that play. Then once again, drops back in the pocket, put it in the hands of your playmaker. Allow them to make the plays after they're able to catch the ball. Hamilton does a great job here. And because things start to open up there, you're able to turn around and hand it off to Barkley. And I don't know what else we can really say about him. His anticipation right there, the guy trying to swipe at his legs to pick him up and put him down. He really does a tremendous job when he's out there playing in this offense.
Yeah, one of the best players in the conference. The transition to the spread's been terrific. And let's remember, one of the reasons James Franklin said he wanted to make this change was to help the offensive line. It's done that. We're not talking about sacks. We're not talking about problems with the offensive line. This offense helps their offensive line perform.
106 points through three games, most for them since 2008.
A few more highlights to get to. The Land of Mary against UCF, and DJ Durkin would go into overtime in this game. In fact, they go into the second OT. UCF is threatening on the third and goal. We're tied at 24. Mackenzie Milton is going to throw the ball. Well, that's a backwards pass. Kingsley O'Hara gets that ball. Plays reviewed. Maryland keeps it, which means the ensuing possession on a first and 10. Kerry Hills gets in trouble. Goes down, picks up 1 yard, but is injured on the play. So, geez, you're in overtime. You need your starter. You're going to have to go to your backup. That's a heck of a lot of pressure for your backup.